section, that there's a positive outlet above bottom, the stone, and hydraulic. Made a comment, Randy showed that the drain tile that he proposed would be a 60-inch perforated PVC drain line, covered and filtered to there. How much would cost would it be to put that drain back down there? The excavation of that? Because why, the drain right now, the water's going through the drain, going by the drain, coming down, and hydraulic going into the basement.
Right, that's why we would drop the sump pit in there, where the hydrant drains down right now. So what you're seeing is the water's going through this hydrant drain, this vertical sheet, and gets to the bottom of the stone. Right now, the pipe is higher than where the bottom of this hydrant drain is. And if we have the cost, that would be the ideal thing to do, is put the drain in by gravity. But the cost to pipe it. And then the other question would be, how do we address the area under the ramp? Because the hydrant drain goes, I think the idea behind putting the hydrant drain behind the ramp is to pick up, drain the water behind the ramp. But the problem is that the pipe wasn't low enough to pick up the water from that other drain.
But the whole wall leaks.
Right.
So if you do the sub-pump on this end, with all the stuff in between the end and the middle, how does that drain?
Well, that's where we extend out the pipe. We would dig it down deep enough to where we would have a wash trench with pipe that goes into the sump, but then you need the pump to pump it up into the pipe by gravity.
So you got more water in there, and you put this pipe in?
Well, we could have to excavate it, but we'd have to excavate it far enough away from the wall to get it drained. So we're not affecting the integrity of the wall. And that's similar to the idea Randy's company had, but they were relying on the pipe to drain by gravity altogether. Which is a good idea, but cost wise.
Well, which is that cost of $10,000?
No, I would say just by putting that pipe in, the amount of excavation you need, we're probably looking at the $20,000.
Just for that drain?
Yeah, probably.
So we're at the $50,000?
I mean, we're looking for, I mean, we didn't do any cost on it, so we want to put together an estimate and then present it back to the village. The ideas Randy's company had were very good ideas. I guess the unknowns are the integrity of the wall, because part of the proposal was to redo the foundation under the wall. So it would be something that I would recommend that the village would have to get structural engineers to make sure that wall, what the integrity of the wall is, as well as basement floor. It was an underdrain system under the floor, which ended up also draining directly to the pond. So the system in the floor would end up draining out to the east directly into the pond, and probably tied into the tile that is on the west wall.
Todd, if we did all this work that's suggested here and did it to the max as we're talking about, could a high degree of assurance then be given that we wouldn't have water in the basement?
I would say that yes, I would say a high confidence level.
Could that be under Bob's proposal?
Well, yes, actually both proposals.
Randy's proposal is much more.
Well, that's a.
That's a big time job. Randy's proposal is $200,000 or more.
Right.
How much, Bob? I couldn't hear.
I bet it's $200,000 plus.
Yeah, plus, yes.
Hey, Todd, as I'm reading Bob Hamilton's again, and I just keep going back to the last paragraph, all lower levels are subject to the pest
Can you comment as to why this work wasn't done originally when the barn restoration was being done the third time? I'm being facetious. When it was being done the originally?
No.
Okay.
I know 2 years ago when we were looking at, we dropped the sump pit into the office, I know that that helped relieve some of the situation. And what we wanted to do was to try to take a step approach also at that time, so drop the pit and extended the pipe in order to extend it in the future if it, it needed additional. And at one point, talking to the plumber a couple of years ago, we talked about putting the pit further on the north wall, but not, we weren't looking at taking it outside, but we were looking at the potential of doing something on the north wall. But I think the approach Bob Hamilton was looking at was trying to get something a little bit cost, reasonable cost, but still try to take step approaches to try to alleviate the problem.
So we have two approaches here. One is well in excess of $200,000. The other one is, let's say, at $50,000. Based upon what you said, generators, you know, just talking about a generator and all that. But if we were to excavate this whole wall here and do it like it should have been done, rather than as it was done per the drawing, what's the probability of it leaking then? If you put the two drains in there, for example, one on the bottom of the footing and one on the top, or, you know, 2 feet up, would that have a high degree of probability of success?
I guess I was, you mean, to put the pipe in by gravity and take it to the pond?
So well, yeah, I don't care, just to get the wall away from the, this wall here, the water away from that wall so it doesn't come in through the basement.
So basically what you have here is what Randy's drawing.
Except on your and Bob's, something like this, something like that.
So instead of putting the sump pit in, to put the,
well, put
the
both in
by gravity.
I put both in if I want.
Well, I think if you end up excavating, doing the tile along the west wall all the way, the one, I guess, question mark comes up is what's under the ramp.
Yeah.
And making sure that drains. But if we get the pipe deep enough and the stone trench in there, the water will end up going down lower to get to the pipe that's below the foundation.
Well, there's no guarantee that we're going to be able to withstand absolutely unprecedented levels of rainfall. But if we have a backup generator, if we have a couple of sump pumps, and if we have some of these other mechanisms put in place, sounds to me like we've got a very, very good chance of remaining dry for a very long time. Sounds like a good plan to me.
Okay. I can see this one plan is a pinch-on plan with the drain tile at the base or below the base. If you envision the elevation of where that would be versus the pond, I'm not sure if you're going to get positive.
I'm not either. I was thinking that same thing.
And you have a very long
hall.
Yeah, that's one of the other
that's what we should do here next, because that doesn't strike me as very expensive to do. Let's do those elevation shots before we take any action here on approving a $75,000 construction contract.
Right, well, that we would, that's what the next step would be. We would have to develop the proper plans, specifications. Basically, we set up a big contract like we do some of our drainage, all of our road programs. That way it's set, and then we can solicit bids that way. But I mean, this is the recommended approach, but I would say we would for sure want to get some type of plan in place that we can, you know, feel comfortable with.
Does the board want to give Todd the authority to go ahead and do what Jim just stated, get those elevations? Because I think we need to, because we got to get moving on this. The sooner the better.
I'm certainly in favor of it. Do you have any kind of cost estimate for that?
Any question?
Do the survey?
Yeah. Hey, Dale says this is a common sense approach. Common sense, Dale, what do you think money wise? $2,000?
Oh, for the survey?
Yeah. Okay,
let's go for the survey.
We'll go for the survey. Everybody agree? Joel?
Yes.
Okay. We got authority to go get the survey done.
How often does the basement get wet now?
Whenever it rains. It's heavy rain, it just literally comes through the walls.
We have a saturated rain. I can say what we've done in the last 3 years to mitigate it is mitigated 90% of the flow. But we do have the periodic with the ground that's saturated and it concentrates there. We do get the water through the concrete. The above the step as well as below, and hydraulics directly through the cracks in the floor.
Jim, how many times over the past, from spring until now, after heavy rains, about how many times do you think that's happened?
I'd say 4 or 5.
I think whenever you have a heavy rain, it's there.
Well, it's certainly way too much.
Yeah, that's a lot.
Yeah, it's back tolerable that about what it's less than it was. We've had some recent rain and we have not had the saturation.
We'll do the survey right away and then
come back and talk to us.
Yeah.
Well, I mean, and Todd, if it's not solvable, if this is a problem, it's not solvable. I mean, just tell us that. Because I'm starting to get the impression that this is not a solvable problem.
Well, I think.
I mean, we keep throwing money at it, and $200,000 I heard mentioned out there. I mean, it was still no guarantees, and I'm glad that Keith, I think, brought up, or maybe it was Alan down there, brought up the fact that in writing here, as I'm reading the memos, I mean, all of you, and I think wisely, are very careful to point out that there are no guarantees, you know? So we keep spending money, and there's still no guarantees. I'm not looking for a guarantee, but I'm looking for a professional statement that there's high probability of problem solved. And I really doubt that we can get to that, but you're the expert.
Okay.
Well,
survey, see what,
yes.
We can see what my gravity does.
If the survey comes in and he has some recommendations, does he have the authority for him to go out and talk to Jim and get some quotations on this?
I would suggest if you get to that point, we have Todd's firm give us a proposal.
supposed to be 24/7 coverage, not considering any temporary redeployment of officers for police emergencies, and an average of between 9.7% and 16.4%, but as low as 3.2% in 2011 for the assigned shared coverage relative to the Rand Road commercial area. The draft resolution you have this evening has findings of fact, which you would be making by passing the resolution, that indicates that based upon analysis by officials of the Village of Deer Park of documents provided to the Village of Deer Park by Kildare in response to FOIA requests submitted by the Village of Deer Park, the corporate authorities of Deer Park have determined that Kildare has substantially and consistently failed to meet the contractual obligations of Kildare to provide police services to the Village of Deer Park as set forth in the Kildare Intergovernmental Agreement for Police Services, that therefore Kildare has committed a material breach of its obligations to the Village of Deer Park under such agreement. It goes on to say the Village of Deer Park gave written, on or about May 4th, 2011, the Village of Deer Park gave written notice to Kildare of the aforesaid breach, and therein gave Kildare a 30-day opportunity to cure said breach pursuant to the terms of the Kildare Intergovernmental Agreement, and that neither during the 30-day opportunity to cure nor thereafter did Kildare propose or provide any satisfactory cure or remedy for its material breach of its contractual obligations as aforesaid, and that has not done so to date, and therefore Kildare has failed to timely cure such breach. It goes on to say that whereas on about May 4, 2011, the corporate authorities of the Village of Deer Park also requested Kildare to negotiate possible changes in the level and cost of police services provided by Kildare to the Village of Deer Park, and the Village of Deer Park and Kildare were unable to reach any agreement relative to such changes within the 90-day period as required by the Kildare Intergovernmental Agreement for Police Services. And in fact, Kildare has made a number of different proposals to the Village of Deer Park, and such proposals were not acceptable to the Village of Deer Park. So that's those are both recitals to the proposed first resolution under my portion of the agenda, as well as I think provide background relative to this matter. I'm happy to answer any questions. I think there were a couple questions actually raised earlier in the meeting. I think most of them relate to the proposed agreement with the Lake County Sheriff, and so I think I'll defer those until that point in the agenda, unless you'd like me to go into them now.
No, as far as the trustees, do you have any questions on this?
What about the response from
Kildare?
Are you at liberty to tell us that?
Maureen, as well as I, this is between the board now. You had your open session.
Okay.
There probably was not a response. Okay, we have a motion to accept a resolution approving and authorizing the termination of a certain police services agreement between the Village of Deer Park and the Village of Kildare.
Yeah, I'd like to make that motion.
Is there a second?
I'll second.
Discussion.
Yeah, I'd like to make some comments if I could, President Kellerman. To our citizens that are gathered here, it's very difficult to sit here and not be able to answer questions. All I can say is that this has gotten extensive analysis. No stone has been left unturned. And that at some point, we hope to be able to answer all questions and have that give and take, that back and forth. Have you asked me any question, ask any of us any questions, and get full and complete answers to your utmost satisfaction.
Let's do it.
It's not possible at this point. I think it will become apparent quickly enough why, but it's not possible at this point.
I concur with Trustee Daniel. You said this is not a monetary issue. The attorneys have stated what the issues are. They are the record. There'll be a resolution. Resolution will be a public document. You all can take a look at it here for you in the Village Office. Okay. May we have a roll? Roll call, please.
Finley?
Yes.
Sands?
Sands?
Hill?
Yes. Sarnick?
Yes.
Thomason?
Yes.
Olson?
Yes.
Denny?
Yes.
Motion carries 6-0. Next item.
The next item on your agenda is a consideration approval of a resolution approving an intergovernmental agreement for contract police services by and among the Village of Deer Park, the County of Lake, and Lake County Sheriff. It's appropriate to just, I took a few notes about the comments that were made at the beginning of the meeting, and I would like to just comment briefly that this proposal comes as a result of a request for proposals that the Village Board did put out, responses were received by the deadline set of September 15th, and then analyzed, and that led to the proposed contract we have before you. Relative to the reference in the proposed contract to the availability of documentation that will be provided, there will be documents that will be received under, if the board chooses to approve this agreement, the documents that will be received from the sheriff, there will be documents that are available for public dissemination, just like through the Village of Kildare Police Department. There will be other documents that because of the law enforcement and security exemptions to the FOIA statute won't be available. And the language of the contract is intended to recognize that the sheriff's law enforcement expertise will be needed to determine whether or not the FOIA exemptions are applicable to requests for documents or not. The proposed contract will have no effect on the liability or risk exposure of the village in terms of the coverage afforded to the village through its self-insurance pool, IML RMA. There are specific provisions in the contract relative to the sheriff providing staff members to staff the red light hearing, automated red light adjudication hearing process, and that's a commitment that's in the contract. I think that those are the points that I noted that I should cover. This contemplates this agreement has not yet been approved by Lake County, and the resolution you approve relative to termination does not go into effect until the Lake County agreement goes into effect. This would be the next step if the board wishes to take it relative to the change
Question.
I want to emphasize again to our citizens here, we will not be without police coverage. If Killdeer decides that they do not want to continue serving us like tomorrow, we have backup plan in place. We will have police coverage that will equal or exceed the coverage that we're now contracted for. We've been very careful to ensure that. There will be no gap in coverage under any scenario.
I'm wondering if it might be permissible to discuss some of the experiences that our neighboring municipalities have had recently with the sheriff's department.
Let me emphasize, first of all, Killdeer Police Department are here. They're obviously professionals, the way they're handling themselves. This is quite a revelation for them. I was going to call, if the village elected to do this, I was calling up their village president tonight on the phone. So some of the comments here are premature. They are professional people. And she said they will honor themselves to do their same professional due diligence. As far as plan goes, this has to be approved by Lake County, and in the event that the Killdeer elected not to do it, but I don't think they are, they are a professional group, we would have the same police protections we have now. There's no compromise. They would be provided by Lake County. There's no reduction of police service whatsoever. It's just a very unfortunate time. Other communities have had, well, most of the police agencies here are highly professional and all have received some pretty high recommendations, including Killdeer. Lakes, Barrington, North Barrington, Long Grove. Those communities have Lake County Sheriff and Lake County high recommendations. So there's done very well for us in the past. We've had a good working relationship. Plans are available to continue. Just to clarify, we have a long, good working relationship with the village of Killdeer. We hope that will continue to do so. I don't think it's going to be compromised. They are professionals, we are professionals, and we'll conduct ourselves in a professional manner. Okay. Roll call, please.
Olson?
Yes.
Sands?
Yes.
Denny?
Yes.
Thomason?
Yes.
Finley?
Yes.
Zernick?
Yes.
I present expiration date, which is April 30th, 2012, for us to withdraw from that agreement. So we don't have to act on this item tonight, and I would suggest we table it. But that we have a window of opportunity under the Lake Zurich agreement to give notice as late as December relative to termination of that agreement. And there isn't any, the cost to us is going to be the same. We're going to be obligated to pay for services through April 30th, 2012. And we're presently paying, I think, about $54,000 a year for this dispatching services. That will be included as part of the sheriff's package of services to the village of Deer Park. Any questions about that?
From the cost savings.
Yes, that will represent the cost savings because of the fact that dispatching will be handled by the sheriff's office. It just comes at a fortuitous time because we are looking at basically basically at the end of your fiscal year. This contract also ends for us, providing we give notice within the next 2 months. The next item on my agenda, my portion of the agenda, is a proposed amendment to the Deer Park Village Code with respect to recent amendments to the Freedom of Information Act and the Open Meetings Act. Actually, these relate just to the Freedom of Information Act. And specifically, the statute, the FOIA statute has been changed in several respects during the last session of the General Assembly. One, this is a kind of unique statute because for the first time in several years, the FOIA statute was actually changed to, in some ways, recognize the challenges that municipalities face. For example, the new statutory amendments define what a recurrent requester is, and a recurrent requester is defined as someone who makes 50 FOIA requests in a 12-month period, or 15 requests in a 30-day period, or 7 requests in a 7-day period. And relative to return requesters, relative to commercial requesters, the villages are now allowed to charge up to $10 per hour after the first eight hours of its personnel time working on retrieving documents. In addition, previously the village had to get the use of certain exemptions under the FOIA statute approved by the Public Access Council or the Attorney General's office in advance. That was if we wanted to use the exceptions related to preliminary drafts, opinions, or notes, or related to if we determined and felt that a particular request would constitute an unwarranted invasion of personal privacy. Relative to recurrent requesters, municipalities are now given a longer period of time, 21 days to respond to those requests. In addition, commercial requesters, those who are making requests for the purposes of sales or solicitation, are no longer afforded the right to appeal the denials of their requests to the public access counselor, although they can appeal to the public access counselor their right, the village's determination that they are a commercial requester. So those are, in summary, the changes to the FOIA statute. The attached ordinance simply basically codifies those
Yes.
Council has one more item. Do you have a response from the hotel?
I do. I did hear from the hotel this afternoon indicating. Pardon me?
Is there a response for it?
It is not. The I didn't ask for a written response. I contacted them at home.
Okay.
And they indicated that the direct, as you are aware, we distributed on Friday a revised draft of the proposed intergovernmental agreement between the village and Deer Park Hotel LLC doing business as the Hamilton Inn. This reflects the fact that basically two things, that in maintaining the ridership log relative to this item, the hotel felt it would be contrary to their obligation of privacy to hotel residents to maintain a list of the names of the residents. Instead, they will maintain the ridership log by maintaining a list of the room number occupied by the rider. And secondly, they asked that the document be made clear that provided the hotel is complying with the terms of the agreement, and they submit a request for reimbursement, a monthly request for reimbursement under this agreement, that the village wouldn't be unreasonable withholding approval of that request. That makes sense. The village wasn't intended to have unfettered discretion relative to approving a monthly request. It was only a process that was provided in the agreement to determine that the ridership log in effect complies with the terms of the agreement. That is, that the riders are being driven to or picked up from destinations within the village of Deer Park. And of course, there are, as requested previously by this board, there are limits on the monthly amount of reimbursement that will be made to the hotel for this expanded courtesy van service. In your agenda package, under the minutes of the 9/19 meeting, there was a resolution approved there was a motion made and seconded and approved by the board approving a resolution approving a certain intergovernmental agreement between the village of Deer Park and the Deer Park Hotel LLC. In order to bring this back before you, that motion to approve this agreement that was approved last month needs to be reconsidered. So everyone who was present at that meeting voted in favor of that resolution. So someone who voted on the prevailing side to approve this intergovernmental agreement at the last meeting needs to make a motion to reconsider that motion.
I'd like to make a motion to reconsider the agreement, intergovernmental agreement between the Village of Deer Park and the
Hamilton. I'll second that.
Okay. Before we have a discussion on this, let me just say this much. Thank the attorney for being good-hearted and working as you are. This board cannot take things at 2 o'clock on Friday.